Hey, the media's willingness to cover for virtually any left-wing narrative benefits the left, not only in allowing them to defend against the insane things that so many folks on the radical left say, but it also pushes a narrative that benefits the left, a narrative of impending doom and crisis, a narrative that America's a terrible place that requires deep-seated change in the nature of the American bargain in order for justice to be done. And every so often, this media experience runs up against reality. First, it convinces a lot of people. You want to know one of the reasons why politics feels so critical today? You want to know one of the reasons why people are so polarized? It's because our amygdalas light up every time there's a headline. Because the media make a lot of money off crisis thinking, off the idea that this is the end of the world, that being alive is, in essence, a dangerous bargain. And none of that is true. So the impact of media coverage on stuff like this is a constant feeling of crisis, which of course would require constant government intervention, bigger government intervention, more cover for people like AOC, who after all are just trying to do the right thing. In the end, the defense that the media make of people like Ilhan Omar and AOC and Rashida Tlaib and Jeremy Corbyn, the defense that they are constantly making of these folks is heavily reliant on the fact that they think that if you have to break a few eggs to make an omelet, you break a few eggs to make an omelet because the world is in peril. And this leads millions of people into a certain crisis mentality about the state of the world that simply is not accurate. So, indicator of that crisis mentality, there's amazing video from the BBC of this crazy group of women who are now suggesting that they are not going to have children because of the danger of global warming. And listen to the rhetoric these women are spouting. And the BBC humoring it, patting them on the head, basically suggesting that maybe they're right. AOC has said the same thing, right? AOC said last week, maybe people shouldn't have kids because of climate change. Now this has become a thing in Britain, women pledging not to have children because of climate change.
Our planet is in a kind of collapse. The natural world is collapsing around us, and that's actually happening right now. And I'm so disappointed by the response by our authorities to this crisis, and so freaked out by it. Everything that I've read, that I've basically last year I came to the decision that I couldn't bring a child into that.
If we're in this situation now, you know, even since my parents had me, we've destroyed 60% of life on this planet. What would that be like when my child's my age? Will there be 10% left?
Okay, this is just sheer craziness. Okay, so she's suggesting humanity's wiped out 60% of animal population since 1970. That is according to a particular environmental report. It is very questionable as to whether this is actually true. Ed Young over at The Atlantic says that finding has been widely mischaracterized. The team behind Living Planet Index relied on previous studies in which researchers estimated the size of different animal populations, whether through direct counts, camera traps, satellites, or proxies, like the presence of nests or tracks. The teams collated such estimates for 16,700 populations of mammals, birds, reptiles, amphibians, and fish across 4,000 species. That covers just 6.4% of the 63,000 or so species of vertebrates, that is backboned animals that are thought to exist. And then they calculated that the size of vertebrate populations has declined by 60% on average, which does not mean that humans have culled 60% of animals. Okay, the report itself says that's not true, but the media covered it as though 60% of animals were dying. That is simply not the case. The media have an interest in promoting the idea that the world is in grave danger so that we hand more power over to ignorant people who pledge to fix everything because the media agrees with their general agenda. Now, here's the reality about the world we live in. It's a pretty unbelievable place. It's a truly incredible place. Here's an article from the New York Times. You want to know about the ingenuity of humankind? You want to know about the incredible innovativeness and adaptiveness of human beings? This is an unbelievable story. This is from the New York Times today. Today, and this will get a lot less coverage than the idea that we are on the verge of a meltdown in terms of human life, and that we must give all control of government to government because of great inequality and burgeoning civil war and all this. It's just not true. Apoorva Mandavilla reporting. HIV reported cured in a second patient. Scientists have long tried to duplicate the procedure that led to the first long-term remission 12 years ago. With the so-called London patient, they seem to have succeeded. For the second time since the global epidemic began, a patient appears to have been cured of infection with HIV, the virus that causes AIDS. The news comes nearly 12 years to the day after the first patient known to be cured, a feat that researchers have long tried and failed to duplicate. The surprise success now confirms that a cure for HIV infection is possible, if difficult, researchers said. Publicly, the scientists are describing the case as a long-term remission. In interviews, most experts are calling it a cure, with the caveat that it is hard to know how to define the word when there are only two known instances. We live in a time when we are developing toward cures for diseases that have wiped thousands of people, and in Africa, tens of thousands of people, off planet Earth. We live in a time when we have wiped out some of the gravest diseases that have ever threatened mankind. We live in a time with more prosperity and more freedom than any time in human history. And we are being told by the media at every turn that everything is a crisis. And if everything is a crisis, then we look for an easy solution. And the easy solution comes in the form of a bumper sticker. The truth is, there are very few easy solutions. The only easy solution is to let people live, to leave people alone, to let innovativeness sprout, to treat other people with a generalized level of tolerance, even if you disagree with them. That's the actual solution. But when the media are constantly promoting the idea of doom and gloom, it's the end of the world, we're all going to die, the natural instinct is to turn to people who share radical solutions. And that aggressive ignorance, again, is not only promoted by media. Anybody who cuts against the aggressive ignorance, anybody who cuts against that narrative is deemed not sufficiently woke. So, for example, best story of the day along these lines. Google has done a study. They studied their own pay. And here's what the study found. They found that men were being systematically underpaid as compared with women. Why does that matter? Because then Google tried to walk back the results of its own studies so as to agree with the generalized narrative that America is sexist, including Google. It's unbelievable. Wokeness, this belief that America is naturally bad, that the West is naturally filled with inequality and poverty and cruelty and malice, and that the earth is dying because of the West, this belief has been so inculcated into the media and by the media that we are willing to buy sheer nonsense from politicians who mirror that belief even as they say crazy things on every other score. And we're willing to overlook all of the worst things they say because, after all, they are morally right. As AOC has said before, factually wrong doesn't matter. Only morally right matters. In a second, I'm going to tell you more about this Google study, which, again, we have known this stuff for years. There is nothing new here. Women are treated unbelievably well in the United States. Women actually have the upper hand when it comes to college degrees. Women have an upper hand when it comes to many life choices. Seriously, in the United States? Okay, let's not pretend that women are a victim class in the United States. They simply are not. That's not to say there aren't individual victimized women. Of course, there are. But that is not the same as saying that females who represent a majority of the voting population and a majority of college-degreed people are a victim class in the United States. It's a ridiculous contention. But we can't say that. If we say that, we're undercutting the narrative of cataclysmic horror that apparently is overrunning the American bargain. We'll talk about that. So as I say, the victory of people like AOC, Ilhan Omar, Rashida Tlaib, and to a certain extent, Donald Trump relies on the media pushing this notion of crisis that we are constantly in. And that notion of crisis is simply not true. And when reality butts up against that narrative of crisis, the media don't know what to do. Neither do our big tech overlords who want to push that narrative. So Google has been pushing the narrative that women are victimized in American society. Then it turns out they conducted a study to determine whether the company was underpaying women and members of minority groups. Instead, Google found, to the surprise of just about everyone, that men were paid less money than women for doing similar work. The study is done every year, but the latest findings arrived as Google and other companies in Silicon Valley face increasing pressure to deal with gender issues in the workplace, from sexual harassment to wage discrimination. Where is that pressure coming from? To a large extent, that pressure is coming from outside woke groups that are interested in promulgating a narrative that counters the facts. Women are treated better in Western civilization, and yes, in places like Silicon Valley, than pretty much anywhere else on Earth. That, again, does not mean that there are not evil men who do evil things. It does not mean that there are individual women who are not deeply mistreated and preyed upon by men. It does mean that if we are going to say that generally women are victimized in American society, that is a load of crap. It is a load of nonsense. Gender inequality is a radioactive topic at Google, says the New York Times. Yeah, you know why? Because the New York Times will rip Google if Google even suggests that gender inequality is not a massive problem at Google. Critics say the result of the pay study could give a false impression. Yeah, who are those critics? Presumably the experts at the New York Times. Company officials acknowledged it did not address whether women were hired at a lower pay grade than men with similar qualifications. Okay, well, then how about some proof? How about some proof as opposed to simply the suggestion? But again, a result that finds that women are not discriminated against is very upsetting to people on the woke scold left. Here is the truth. Here's the truth. As early as 2010, there was a study reported in Time magazine and had found that in 147 out of the 150 biggest cities in the United States, the median full-time salaries of young women were 8% higher than those of guys in their peer group. In 147 out of 150 of the biggest cities in the United States. And that figure, by the way, has not budged. Okay, the gap is huge in places like New York City, LA, and San Diego. 17%, 12%, 15% as of 2010. That applies to unmarried, childless women under 30 who live in cities. Right, because women who have children end up having other obligations. Women who get married tend to change their priorities. That is not the fault of employers. But to point out these facts is to undercut the consensus woke view of the world. And that cannot be allowed by the media.